All right, everybody, today I'm going to be showing you a video I shot. It's been at least a year or two ago, but it's on how to build a foundry pattern for a cast iron angle plate. All right, everybody, welcome back to the old iron shop.
Okay, so for the next step here, I want to make a tool that goes with the pattern. The pattern's pretty much complete. We're just waiting for these fillets to cure here. Then we'll sand and paint this and get it all sort of finished off. More or less, that's done. That's the way the part was going to come out of the sand looking, just like that. But if they say this is the molding board, they put that down, mold it up, when they flip it over, all this stuff under here is going to be all full of sand. So when they flip it over, all you're going to see is just this little knife edge here on these two points. So that means that the molder is going to have to dig out all this sand here. You know, and he's going to be scratching away at the pattern, and you know, that's going to add some wear and tear to it, but you know, it's also, it's taking him time to do that. And also he'll have to part down on this face here too to get that exposed so he can pull this out. So we're going to make a tool that actually will sort of eliminate pretty much all of that. So we're going to cut out a piece that this here will fit on, about yay wide, about that long or so. So we can set this here. We're going to cut some triangles. This is just a scrap that will fit right into here really nice. And we're going to leave it stick proud. We're going to glue it down to the board. We're going to put a big draft on this thing. A lot of taper. So it comes out real easy. Put one on each end. And then under here, we've got another undercut. So we're going to take this piece here. And we're going to rip it at a 45 so it'll fit underneath there. We'll glue that down, and that should need very little work. Probably we'll have to put a little draft out here at the end, and I think that will probably finish up the follower board. So I'll do a little bit of layout work here, and we'll be back. All right, we're back. So if you can see here, this was just a piece of scrap that I had glued together an eternity ago. I don't even know when. It's been a very long time, but you know, I'm trying to do this with not having to buy any new wood. So anyway, I've laid out two triangles here. Tried to be as economical as I could with the wood. I left myself just the littlest bit of a room right here so my saw kerf will fit in there. And we're gonna go ahead and cut this apart. All right. So one of the nice features of this vise is that I can actually tip it up this direction, and you can swivel it. What else can you do? Oh, you can actually unlock this here, and it'll tip this direction, so you can actually grab things that are not square, which of course is doing patterns. You know, you always have stuff with draft on it, so it's always good for that. Anyway, these are really handy. So if you're ever going to get into pattern making, this is exact tool you want to find. Wish I could remember the name of the antique ones that are out there. But they're really expensive. Kind of a collectible market for those things. Let me grab a chisel. And go ahead and throw a little notch on here so we can get started. Nice thing about this, I got a line here and also got a line there, so I can sight both those lines at the same time. That'll help me get this cut square. Come on. Now we we got to cut some more waste off here. Let's see, maybe do it better. I think to cut this way. Takes so little time to do. I do it most of the time, even if I probably don't even really need that accuracy. But right. One part. Now let's cut the waste off of this one. A lot of times, people that have never used hand tools, they think, oh, you know, they're slow and whatnot. But a lot of times, if you can just lay out a line, a solid line, you can see there's just a little shadow of a line left there. Sometimes it's faster to just pick up a saw and just cut something, you know. And you got to be confident in your ability to cut square. But the only way you get that is by practicing, you know, and using the hand tools a lot. At any rate. And then, you know, I could have put it in a miter box or something, I suppose, to get that, but let's just see how they fit. All right, now, I put witness marks on these. Single line on this side, two lines on that side, so that'll orient these parts where they can fit just like that. But remember, we got that fillet in there, so we're going to have to nip off this corner a little bit. Everybody's favorite tool in the shop. Put that on there. Oh, I'm getting ready to cut on piece instead on my pinch hook. In there pretty good. So take off just a little bit more. I don't want to leave a big old gap. The better this fits, the less finishing work the molder has to do once he's got it in the sand. Pretty good actually. This needs to angle that direction, so I'm going to go back over here. I've got that rounded already, so that's no big deal. Sand it, I guess, and clean this all up a little bit more. But anyway, we're going to plane some draft onto that. And I want to leave maybe just a quarter of an inch or so over here. So we'll go back to the pattern maker's button. All right, so we'll take this plane here, we're gonna kind of auger this off here. Be kind of careful with this guy here. You could remove way too much too quick here if you're not careful. Tool guy would have to do something like this, he'd probably have to come up with some kind of a board. They could run through a joint or a planer at an angle, so he could put that on there, and that's just sure sounds like an awful lot of work for something that's probably only a one-time job. Unless you're making this all the time. Smoothing plane, some lines on here just so we can kind of see where we're going. Over the first few passes there, we'll be able to see ridges. This is all scooped. Alright, give me a minute here. Let me see if I can't figure out some way of holding this a little bit better. Alright. It just took me a few seconds here, and I had this as a little scrap of stuff I had cleaned down the quarter inch. Took a couple of cuts in it. I'm going to put it down with some of these brass braids. These are good because in case you get out of control with your plane, you know, that won't do too much damage to the blade. Oh, I suppose we can be picky and put square on here. Once I got this made, now I'll have this tool here for doing planing work on little small 45 pieces for whatever reason. They call this a planing stop. A lot of times you would just have a little piece like that and you'd be working on, say, something like this. A lot of times what I'll use is these bench dogs. Push one up. And the nice thing about these, they're infinitely variable. You can poke it up that high, or you could butt up a piece of wood against that, and then just run your plane along there. It works real good. Just happens that I needed one of the 45 today. All right. See how, I mean, you could push the bench along probably before you move that. Or the device tightened up. There should be plenty of draft on that piece. Okay, we got that one there. Plane all that off. Back to our scrub plane. Alright, so we got the taper, plane on those. You can see the profile there. So this lays nice and flat, and bevels this way. So, time to go back to the screaming machines, I guess. We've got to cut out this board over here. Make us a little plate that we can attach all these pieces to. And we also got to cut those little 45 pieces. Okay, so if I make one cut off of this thing here, I've already got the saw sort of set up where I think I need to make the cut. It'll be plenty long enough to make both pieces that I need. So I'm just going to take one cut all the way down to the end here, and that'll be that for this. I'm doing this first because that plywood cuts a lot better with the crosscut blade. And I got to make a rip cut, so it's already in here, so why change it just to change back? Alright, I left it a little extra thick right here because the feather edge like this is real delicate, so I'm going to glue this down to the board, so that's fine, but this is going to be knot right there. So anyway, so I'm ready to cut this piece up. I already got it kind of marked out. So I'm gonna cut it at 90 degrees, then we'll put the draft on it here in a second. Alright, I just want to make sure I'm cutting this piece the right way. Alright, now I'm gonna tip the saw blade over, let's say 15 degrees. Yeah, what the heck, let's go like 20 degrees. Cuts on this setting. Well, it worked pretty good, except I got one little splinter chipped out in between the layers, but that's alright, we'll just put a little bit of putty in there. Alright, I ended up having to sharpen this portioner bit. So, see if we can make this hole a little bit faster. Let's go. Glue, veneers crisscrossing back and forth. It's, I don't know if this style of a bit was really designed for that sort of work. But anyway, so that's how you drill a hole with a brace. You actually lean on it with your forehead while you're drilling, put pressure down into the cut. Well, there we go. There's a couple of nice holes, and that should make it easy to pick up. Alright. Let me clean this all up. I'm going to make quite a mess now. Alright, I'm going to go ahead and put this thing here to the use a second time already. We don't like square corners, so I'm going to put a little chamfer on here. And this is certainly a lot easier than trying to hold it by hand. This is a useful little appliance we've made. Alright. Like that. We'll hit that with a little sandpaper. I already sanded this bottom edge. Probably should clean up this. Needs to be sanded a little more. So we'll do that. Sand the bottom, or the mating surface. It's always good to have nice, fresh, clean wood. That way any dust or oil or anything that might have gotten on there doesn't interfere with the glue strength. So anyway, we're gonna do a little bit of sanding and then we'll come back again. Alright, so we're all ready to glue up, and don't know my own strength. Alright, what we're gonna do is glue these triangles on first, and then I'm gonna have to do a little bit of work on that other piece. Make sure you get your bevels going the right direction here. That one goes on that side. So I'm going to show you how to do a rub joint. So rub joint, you just spread your little bit of glue on here. It's actually really easy, but nice thing, even layer. I've got some lines down here that I want to end up on. I push this down and wiggle it around a little bit, kind of rubbing it back and forth. It's forcing the glue out of there, and I can feel it starting to drag a little bit. And it'll get to a point here, it'll actually sort of almost just seize right on. There, that's it. Right there. Alright. Dump off the excess. And this is actually a really handy technique, because once it's set on there, it's actually pretty durable as far as like bumping into it or something like that, you know. Okay, so we'll leave that one alone for a little bit. Put this one here on. And that's long grain to long grain, so that's going to be a really strong joint once the glue sets, so we won't need to worry about any other fasteners or anything like that. There was a time when a cabinet maker, metal hardware is expensive. You got to have a blacksmith make your nails and screws and stuff for you. It was just too expensive. So they would use wooden pegs and all kinds of things, and you know, with the proper joints, all that stuff is, in some situations, better than a mechanical, you know, a metal fastener. Okay, get that excess off of there. Years, whoever goes and looks at the bottom of my bench is going to be horrified at the amount of glue that's been wiped off onto it. Alright, I just want to test the pattern on here and just verify that this is actually going to fit how I put it. Hopefully I don't mess anything up in the process here. Alright, that'll work pretty good there. So see, this taper comes up and just kind of almost disappears right there. Same thing on this side. It's close enough for what we're trying to accomplish here. Alright. So we're going to turn the camera off. Well, kind of screwed up here, but not unsalvageable. I left this little parallel face on here thinking, I don't know what the heck I was thinking, but I was definitely wrong. So what I need to do is... this is going to lay like this, and I need to, you know, trim it off here this way a little bit. So, we'll just do that with block plane. Oh, it's sitting right here. Alright, no big deal. Wax it up. Alright, check that out, make sure that's good. Do this one here, same way. Again, this ain't a really fussy angle, it just needs to be more than 1.5 degrees or so. Okay, next step, and these triangle pieces are still, they're still drying on there. What we need to do, we need to cut this way across here just so we get draft on the ends of this. I just saw that off of the small cross cut, so we'll grab a pencil and we'll just kind of more or less mark out where we need to trim it. From about there, about there, and we better put a match mark. There's a one on that side, put two over here. Mark out this piece while we're over here. Alright. Let's move this out of the way so we don't damage our drying stuff over here. So we're just gonna kinda line up. A little excess there. I don't think that's gonna make it. Is this thing dull? Alright, I'm gonna have to get a mallet. Alright, I'm gonna have to point it up against the wall here of some sort. bit. Well, you can see, cut it off, but not very cleanly. Alright, so now you can see. And you can see that we got that taper there. So when this is all put together, this will all come out of the sand very easily. So let's go ahead and get some glue. We'll glue these guys here down. Spread the glue. Rub this joint together just like we did on the other parts. It's nice to be able to have the pattern in here so I can, as I rub this together, I can make sure it fits right on to the pattern. Notice sometimes when you wipe that glue into the corner, it'll almost make a fillet for you. Although, you know, not very much of one. Alright. Glue on this other one here. We're almost done with this now. It'll just be a little bit of a paint job. And as soon as I get some money, that's the biggest problem. Get some money and we take this down to the foundry and we can cast up some of these. Really thought too much about the size of this thing here, but I wonder if it'll if I can bolt it to my faceplate for my lathe. Sometimes it's convenient to hold a piece that way. Stick. So, like I said, one really complicated piece here, just making a silly follower board, but you know, we're just here having fun anyway. Alright, I just had some scrap from this here. I wanted to kind of reinforce this to make it a little stronger, so we're going to glue these blocks in there. And we're going to do our rub joint again. Register the stuff on there real good. The pattern, to make sure the pattern sets, you know, laterally and we don't get too far one direction or the other. Nice thing about this technique is you don't need to clamp. Done. It's pretty much already starting to catch, really. Alright. Still gotta wait for this to dry here before I dare do it, but I need to plane down it. Well, I want to, I could let it go, but I want to plane the top of this down a little bit. When the pattern sits on here, this back edge, yeah, there's a step right there. Well, we don't really need that step, so I'll just plane that flat. And that'll be a less delicate thing in the foundry. They're knocking stuff around. It's not the ballet, people trying to get stuff done. So, but that little edge will get beat up really easy. So, I don't know how wide is this. Got it under the right direction here. Okay, that's the right spot. Yeah, I need to put a. I'll do it right now. Put a match mark right here, like this. So we know where. Which way that thing is supposed to go on there. Later on, we'll come up with something. Probably put a different little stripe of color or something on one end, that way they know to put it on a particular way. I don't think it's going to matter too much, but alright, I think that's good for now. Okay, I just split some pieces out with the chisel and put a little glue on them. I put the piece on here, put the pattern on here where I wanted it, and then I just reached inside and kind of squeezed it together. So that's actually not even dry yet, but I won't need to mess with that too much. What I want to do now, this is set good enough that I can plane this off here. So. Into the camera. You can see I already got a little dent on that corner. Right. Take that corner away a little bit too. Sandpaper. I'd say we're done with as far as construction is.
All right, guys. I hope you enjoyed that little episode of building foundry patterns. There's more of them. They'll definitely be linked in the video. If you enjoy this kind of stuff, please click on the horizontal mill icon to subscribe. And I'll have plenty more coming. I've got just about 100 videos as of right now. So there's plenty to keep yourself entertained. All right, see you around.